And all you that go to children's church, you can be dismissed.
Faithful Father, enduring friend, your tender mercies like a river with no end, it overwhelms me. Covers my sin each time I come into your presence. I stand in wonder once again. Your grace still amazes me. Your love still a mystery. Each day I fall on my knees. Your grace still amazes me. Your grace still amazes me. Amazes me.
Beautiful song. I hope you ain't got over your salvation. I was sitting there. I don't know about you, but I was just sitting there worshiping God and just thinking about my Father in heaven. And I was just thinking about how merciful He is, how gracious He is. There's judgment that's being held back right now because He's long suffering. You know? It's coming. God will judge sin, but His grace and His mercy withholds it to give us an opportunity to tell somebody about Jesus, but in my case, it gives us the opportunity to repent too and get my life right with Him. His mercy and grace. I hope you ain't got over that, boy. We don't need to get over our salvation, boy. We ought to be excited about our Father being gracious and saving us. We're going to get right in there and talk about that new heaven and earth, Revelation chapter 21, verse 1. We're going to read it again if you stand with me this morning. I told Courtney, we're going to move right along. Try to get you out of here on time today, right, John? Right. All right, one verse of Scripture, Revelation, chapter 21, verse 1. Read this to kick off our message this morning. It says this, John, he's seeing a few things. It says, John, and I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. Let us pray. Father, we thank You for Your grace. God, I ain't got over Your grace, Your mercy. God, You showed me as a sinner, willing to give Your Son to die for me. God, ain't nobody ever did anything like that for me. God, I ain't got over it. This morning, I just want to thank You and praise You for it. It's being my Heavenly Father. I thank You for Jesus. I thank You for the Holy Spirit of God. We just want to praise You. I pray that You'll be glorified in everything said and done. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. You know, I've shared with you over last week or two from the Bible about heaven, and we ought to be excited about heaven. We've learned heaven's is a narrow way to heaven. There's not many traveling that narrow way. We learned that heaven's a promise Jesus made us, that He would go away to prepare a place for us. Last week, we talked to you about all things new. God give us a new life and salvation. I don't know about you, but I'm not the same person I used to be. I got a new life now. And that's what salvation does for an individual. You're not that same old sinner you used to be. You're new. So we talked about that last week. And yet, future, God is also going to give us a new body. We'll have a new body. When we talk about heaven, we're talking about new stuff. You know, when we're talking about God giving us and promising us, and oftentimes that should be encouraging to you this morning. I hope that encourages you to know that you're going to get a new body one day. I'm excited about that. You know, Judy needs a knee replacement right now, and she won't have to worry about a knee replacement one day because she's going to get a new body. So when we think about that, we've shared several thoughts about that. And the title is Heaven, All Things New is what we've been preaching. Don't you want to know what your future holds? I mean, do you not want to know something about where you're going to spend eternity? I mean, you know, we should want to know more about heaven, the place that we're going to spend eternity. And we're going to be excited about that. And that's what the challenge that's been before me is to, boy, I've just been reading and studying. I've listened to preachers. I went down the road yesterday, even when I was traveling back and forth from Silas City to graduation, several trips yesterday, and I had my earbuds in, and I was just looking at, I don't know if y'all looked at the sky yesterday with the storms and the sun and all of it. It looked glorious at times. And boy, I was riding down the road and I was listening to John MacArthur, and he was talking about all this passing away, all of it being gonna be gone, and all things being new. Boy, I was feeling the Holy Spirit move during the car. You know, just thinking about this glorious. Heaven's gonna be a glorious place. The promise is Jesus made us in John 14:31, he said, I go away to prepare a place for you. That's a promise. A place is a spot, a location. He's got a place for every believer. There's a place for you, and he's prepared a place for you. So today, we're gonna talk a little bit about heaven again. The new heaven, a place that we should hunger for. A new heaven is a place that we should hunger for. And that's what, it should be a hunger in our hearts. And we're going to talk about that a little bit today, as even being point one. Say a little bit about the events here in Revelation. If you turn to Revelation, you're already there, to chapter one, how the book starts out. I just want you to take a look at that for a minute, because we are going to go through chapter 21 eventually. I promise. We're going to get there eventually. But I just want you to look at Revelation 21:1. This, the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him to show unto his servant the things which must shortly come to pass, he sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John. Now we're looking at here. This is the revelation of Jesus Christ. In the book of Revelation, if you don't remember nothing else, Jesus is going to be revealed for who he is. Lord of lords and King of kings. He came as a servant, as one to die on the cross the first time. But when he returns to this earth for this last time, when he sets foot on this earth, it's going to be as King of kings and Lord of lords. And everyone that scoffed at him, everyone that's denied him, everyone that said, you're foolish to follow Jesus, they're going to look up in that sky and they're going to see him coming back in all his glory on that horse. And all of us is going to be with him, and all the angels of heaven. And he's going to set foot on this earth and set up a kingdom. And they're going to know that Jesus is Lord of lords and King of kings. And they, all them scoffers is going to be like this, just looking. They ain't going to believe it. I think I'm going to say, I told you so. It was true. Yes, somebody's going to say that. Notice the scripture said in verse 1, it must shortly come to pass. It's a short time. You say, well, preacher, he's been gone over 2,000 years. How is that short? We forget. Over in Peter told us, a day with the Lord is as out of 1,000 years. So he ain't been gone 2 days. To the Lord's, on the Lord's clock, you forget we're not on, God ain't on our clock. God don't run after a 365-day calendar. And that's not his calendar. Is that Peter's telling? We're going to look at that verse over here in 2 Peter 2, where he says, a day with the Lord is as 1,000 years. He ain't been gone long. So yeah, all these people say, oh, he's been gone over 2,000 years. And they scoffed at it in Peter's day. They were scoffers then. We're going to read that scripture today. They're scoffers today that says, oh, y'all foolish to get down there and follow after Jesus. Give your life to Jesus. You know, and people scoff at him. But when he comes back, and it says it must shortly come to pass. It must. It's going to. And we see this with the rapture of the church we talked about last. You know, the key event, as we talked about last week, is the rapture of the church. Remember, to be caught up, to be snatched out of here in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, the dead in Christ shall rise first, and they which is alive, bam, out of here. Just like that. They ain't going to know what happened. In a blink of an eye, gone. So the rapture is a key event. When we think this, let's look at this rapture. What did I say last week? We're in the church age now. Right now, we're in the church age. Then, hey, that's going to come to an end. The rapture of the church is going to take place. Then we're going to go into this, on this earth, they're going to go into a tribulation period, what we call 7 years of tribulation. And we're not going to be here. The church is going to be raptured. We've got that tribulation period that's going to take place. at the end of that tribulation period, we're going to see the Battle of Armageddon take place. You've heard about it. Blood as deep as the horse's bridle. We read about those things in Revelations, the end battle. It's going to take place at the end of 7 years, and Christ will be here. He will be here. He'll arrive, and he'll set up his thousand-year millennial reign here on earth. Satan will be bound for 1,000 years, be put into that pit, and Christ will return and set up his kingdom for 1,000 years. At the end of 1,000 years, remember, Satan will be loosed for a brief time, and then the battle of all battles will take place. All of them will be destroyed. Satan will be bound. He'll be cast into a lake of fire. And then after that, we see Revelation 21. Now, the great white throne judgment takes place at that time, and then the new heaven and new earth. You should have read, you got to look at it as a timeline. You can, if you can picture it in your mind as a timeline, you see these events taking place. That's what we see here. The events that must shortly come to pass. Just a short time. It ain't long. We think it's long because in our life, you know, we feel like 65 is a long time. Boy, that's old. Some of you young people sitting here today says, that's old people, ain't it? Ain't that right? You know, look at me like, that is old people. You say, well, that's old people. They lived a long time. My grandma lived to be 93 years old. You think, boy, that's a long time. Not on God's timetable, it ain't. It describes this life in the Bible as just a vapor. It's just brief. You see anybody boil water on the stove? You see your mama boil water? See that steam, that vapor come up off that water? It's gone. That's what our life is. It's brief. And some of you young people sitting here thinking, you know, it's graduations are going on this time of year. Proms are going on this time of year. Our niece graduated yesterday. I remember I was there when she was born in the hospital. You know, I remember all that. And I'm like, boy, I feel old now. She's graduating from high school. You know, but with God, that's nothing. That's a brief time. You'll blink and life will be gone. You'll say, where's your kids? Your kids is gone. Look how big he is. Isaiah turned 13 yesterday. 13. You know, time so 1,000 years. Don't worry about it, guys. He said and made a promise. And what I say earlier, he always keeps his promise, don't he? He's coming. He's coming. You know, when we think about that, after all these things take place, then we see this new heaven, new earth. You know, mankind has strived to make this place a perfect place. And don't they? Oh, we got to save the earth. We got to do all these things. We can do this and create an environment of peace on earth, can't we? We hear it every year, don't we? How are they doing? Not so good. In this current world, there'll be no peace. There'll be no perfect peace. We failed at peace. But God's people are always looking toward what direction? Heaven. We're always looking up. What I say, we should have a hunger in our heart to see Jesus. We should have a hunger in our heart for this glorious place called heaven. Jesus, he was teaching his disciples the Lord's Prayer. All of you heard about the Lord's Prayer. Jesus was teaching his disciples the Lord's Prayer, teaching them how to pray. And he said this in here, thy kingdom come. Y'all know this? Thy kingdom come, thy will be done as it is in heaven, right? On earth as it is in heaven. He says, thy kingdom come. Why did he tell his disciples to pray, thy kingdom come? Why did he tell them to do that? Why did Jesus say, and that's us. It expresses that desire, that hunger in our hearts that we should have to see God's kingdom, to see that glorious place called heaven. That's what we're praying. Thy kingdom come. I want to be a part of it. It expresses my desire to see the promise of God fulfilled. You know, that's what he was telling us to pray. Thy kingdom come, Lord. I want to see it. I want to have that hunger in my heart to see Jesus. Don't get comfortable here. Don't get comfortable here on this earth. Let's look at Hebrews. I'm going to turn over to Hebrews right quick. Hebrews, it's a few pages over in chapter 11 in your Bible. Hebrews chapter 11. Look at a verse of scripture there. Verse 13 and 14. chapter 11, verse 13, 14, book of Hebrews. You got it? Everybody got it? Say amen. Amen. It says, and this is a chapter 11. It's got all these Old Testament heroes that we've heard about and their faith, Abraham, Sarah, Noah, Enoch. We see all these in the chapter 11. These are the people from the Old Testament that had faith in God. They had faith as Abraham. God made him a promise, but Abraham didn't ever see the promise fulfilled, did he? But he had faith. He believed. He always had a hunger. I'm always looking for that city. I'm always looking for that kingdom of God. You'll see that in the life of those Old Testament saints. And this is what it said, verse 13. These all died in faith. They died in faith. They died believing. They died. They had faith that they was going to see this kingdom. It says, not having received the promise. They didn't actually get to lay hands on it yet. But having seen them afar off, they were persuaded of them and embraced them and confessed that there were strangers. They were strangers, listen to that, and pilgrims on this earth. We forget that. We are strangers and pilgrims on this earth. We're looking for the promise. They had their eyes fixed on heaven. They had their eyes fixed up in the eastern sky, just looking. Oh, it could be any time now. We'll hear that trump of God. The dead in Christ will rise first. It could be any moment now. It should be that anticipation in our heart. Any moment now. See, we don't have that urgency. And that's what they said. They said they were strangers and pilgrims here on earth. It sort of puts everything in perspective here too also when we look at that scripture. It says in verse 14, for they that say such things declare plainly, listen to this, that they seek a country. They seek that country. That seeking that scripture means they have a desire. They have a hunger. To see it. They seek after it. They're longing for it. There's a real desire in their heart to see the promise of God be fulfilled. To see glory. That's what it is. They seek after it. I'm a pilgrim and stranger here. I'm just passing through here. This ain't my home. Don't set your roots down. Don't let them run too deep. This ain't your home here. So when we think about that, we as believers, it was declared throughout the Old Testament. We think it's just New Testament. Heaven's just New Testament thing. No. God told them all throughout the Old Testament. He made the promise of heaven. Let me read this to you. Isaiah 62:22. For as the new heavens and the new earth, which I will make, shall remain before me, saith the Lord, so shall your seed and your name remain. You see that? For as the new heavens and the new earth. He spoke of it even back in the book of Isaiah. Throughout the Bible, revealing heaven to his people. Isaiah 65:17. For behold, I create new heavens and a new earth. The former shall not be remembered nor come to mind. What's he saying? This place called heaven is so glorious. It's so glorious that you'll forget about this place. That's what he told Isaiah in the book of Isaiah, that these new heavens and this new earth is so glorious, you'll forget about the old earth and the old heavens. He said, they'll be remembered no more. And we thought. He said, well, I like the place to live here. Well, some of you know, we like our house. But I know that house is just temporal. I know that's not my permanent place. Jesus said, I make a permanent place for you. This house right here, that apartment you may be living in, that single wide trailer you're living in, that double wide, whatever it may be that you're living in, that's temporary. Jesus said, I got a place for you. We have to hold on to that. We have to remember that should bring comfort and peace to our heart as we live in this world right now. So they look, we think about it, they seek and they're striving, there's that hunger. Turn with me over to 2 Peter right quick. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 13. We're going to spend some time in 2 Peter in just a little bit. But I'm going to go ahead and read this right now. 2 Peter, give you time. Say amen when you get there, chapter 3 and verse 13. It says this, nevertheless, we according to his promise, notice that, we look for the new heavens and the new earth, wherein dwelleth righteousness, a place where righteousness dwells. But that's what I want to focus on. I want to look on that word look. That he said, we nevertheless, according to his promise, we look for the new heavens and the new earth. Peter, what's Peter telling us? Listen, we look, when he says we look, that's we expect. We anticipate. There should be an anticipation in our heart. We should expect that the promise that God made us is going to be fulfilled. But when we think about, we live our daily lives, we remember, man, this is a temporary job I'm going to. Man, it gets on my nerves. These people get on my nerves. I'm tired of going there. I like the company I work for. It's aggravating. It's temporary. It's temporary. They say, well, you know, I don't like the house I live in. I wish I had a big house. I wish I had a nice house. I wish I had a swimming pool. Just remember, that's temporary. Right. They say, well, you know, I like to have a new car. I like having, you know, I like having a new car, a new truck. You know, I like having a new truck. You know, remember, that's temporary. Remember this. Them clothes you got on your back, you ain't going to take none of them with you. Not one of them. That cell phone in your pocket, you ain't going to need that in heaven. You said there ain't going to be no iPhones in heaven? Are you serious? What kind of place is that? No iPhone? We ain't going to need no iPhone. We're going to be fixed on Jesus. We're going to be worshiping and praising and serving him in heaven and do it like never before. We ain't even going to worry about that former life. We ain't even going to give it a thought. That's what he told Isaiah. We ain't going to think about that former earth. You ain't going to think about that iPhone. He said they're going to have PS4s there. They're going to have PS4s in heaven. Fisher, they're going to have PS4s in heaven. So you would think they would, wouldn't you? Have a laptop, computer, Wi-Fi. You know, no Wi-Fi. We ain't going to need Wi-Fi. Huh? We don't need Wi-Fi. Any of that. All of the stuff, y'all, anything you can mention, you remember, is temporal. It's temporal. It's temporal stuff. It's what he said. We're looking. We're anticipating. That's what he's telling us here in 2 Peter. We're anticipating. We're looking for that promise. We anticipate a lot of things here on earth, don't we? We anticipate to graduate. Say, boy, I can't wait to graduate high school. I can't wait to get out of this place. And I'm tired of going down here every day. Tired of listening to that teacher every day. You know what I'm saying? I just get, whew, I got to do it again. Again today. You wake up, it's Monday. Tomorrow you're going to wake up Monday. Oh, yeah, that's what we say. Especially most of Jonah a lot of time. Isaiah jumps out of the bed and this time Jonah's in there like, oh, roll it around. You know, you tell him five times, hey, Jonah, get up. It's time for breakfast. Jonah, get up. Time for breakfast. You know, you say, you ain't going to worry about no school. But we anticipate graduate. Somebody's going to have a new baby. And some of you, grandparents, some of your grandparents, boy, you can't wait to see that new baby. There's anticipation in your heart. Boy, I can't wait to see that new baby. You know, things like that. We anticipate getting married one day. Boy, I can't wait to find Mr. Wright. That handsome, good-looking man that's got an education, got a lot of money, and all that. Boy, I just anticipate getting married. And then you get engaged. Boy, that anticipation level goes through the roof. Boy, I gotta find me a wedding dress. I got a ring on my hand now. Look at this ring I got on my hand now. I'm gonna have a wedding band in just a few days. We're gonna be married. There's an anticipation in our heart here on earth. We're looking for something to happen. Now, some of us are gonna retire from work. John, getting close, ain't you? Some of you might say, well, I already retired sometime. There's an anticipation. How was that last year of work, boy? Boy, that working third shift, get off you piss. Boy, I'm getting off third shift soon. Boy, mama, I'm going to be home soon with all of you. There was anticipation in his heart. There was anticipation in the heart of mama. There's anticipation in the heart of kids. Boy, I can't wait till that day. But boy, how much more should we feel that way about heaven? Right. Boy, we would wake up. Brother, I say that should be anticipating your heart. It's not my home. I'm going to go blow on that saxophone one more time today. I'm going to go to that class one more time, take that test I don't want to take one more time today. I'm going to do it for God's glory. This is not my home. Hey, think about this. I don't know. The Bible don't tell me there's any kind of test in heaven. Some of you are saying amen right there. There's no vocab test, no math test, no history test. I mean, some of you are, boy, that ought to be anticipation for heaven. That ought to raise your level of anticipation, boy. I ain't got to deal with no more sickness. I ain't got to deal with no more sorrow. I ain't going to have to deal with no more death. I ain't going to have to deal with no more separation from the ones I love. Man, that our anticipation level for heaven, or just it'll go through the roof. We ought to be excited. That's what I'm saying. We We get excited about the things, but how much more should we be looking towards the Lord, looking towards heaven, and say, God, you promised. And guess what? You've never broke your promise. Boy, that's, see, when I said Jesus promised something, y'all didn't miss that message a few weeks ago. When I said that, the gravity of that, I don't think really hit us. That, you know, humans, on a human perspective, you know, we break our promises. But for Jesus, he's never broke a promise. So when he says, Miss Ryan, I'm talking to you, Miss Ryan, when he promises you heaven, Brother Ryan, guess what? You're going to go to heaven as long as you know Jesus Christ as your Savior. You say, you better look out because I may call your name out. Might know Mason. I might say your name. You better be looking on. Everybody's going to be looking. I'll keep calling your name until you look. Amen. There's anticipation. Listen, you won't have to worry about that in heaven. You won't have to worry about that in heaven. Yeah. And so, praise the Lord, heaven. There should be an anticipation in our heart about heaven. Heaven and earth. We think about heaven and earth being new. This is the second thing I'm going to share with you. Go back over to Revelation 21 for this. Just a few minutes, then we're going to go back over to 2 Peter. Go over to Revelation 21. You know, we read verse 1. We read verse 1 as an opening. Let me just say this. When it comes to a new heaven and a new earth, what's new? What does that mean? What does a new heaven and new earth mean? There's two main theological points in our country, in our world, concerning a new heaven and a new earth. And it's the one is this, that this heaven and this earth that we're living on right now will be completely destroyed, and they will be a new heaven and a new earth. That's one theological point. That's the one all of us has probably heard our whole life, right? That this earth that we're on right now, gone. It's going to be destroyed. The heavens, in the Hebrew language, in the primitive Hebrew language, they didn't have a word in their vocabulary to describe the universe. All that we see. They didn't have a word to describe that, so they always used the word heaven to describe that. Now, we know John said, I took up the first heaven, second heaven, third heaven. You know, we see that, levels of heaven. But in their language, they didn't have a word to describe the universe. So when we read in 2 Peter about the heavens, they're talking about this whole universe, everything. So there is one theological view that everything will be destroyed, they'll be new. The second is that heaven and earth will not be destroyed completely, but they will be renewed or renovated. It will go through a purification process. And that being that any signs of sin that's on this earth right now or beneath this earth, any effects of sin we've seen, any resemblances, signs, anything of that nature will be removed, and they'll go through a purification process, but God won't destroy this earth and heaven completely. Say, who believes that? Well, if you read after, I love Dr. David Jeremiah. That's his perspective. If you read after Henry Morris, that's his great men of God. And we're looking at words like new and what they mean. So when we think about that, that's two theological views. And keep them in mind as we study, as we look at these scriptures in Peter. We're going to go to Peter in just a minute. Revelation 21, I want you to notice this. John said, I saw. He said, I saw. What's it mean if I say I saw something? You actually seen it, right? John said, I saw. It's to stare out. It's to discern clearly. So this ain't no figment of his imagination. John said, I saw. An angel showed it to me. What he's writing here in verse 21 is what John actually saw. It's a testimony of John to say, I saw this. I discerned this. I see it clearly, the new heaven and the new earth here. And he, notice what he said about it. He said this new heaven and this new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth, it passed away. Now, these words are critical as to what you believe about this earth. And in a sense, Brother Mike, if you look at the two theological views, in either one, there'll be no sin, there'll be no sorrow, and everything will be new. So everything's going to be new. It's going to be a new heaven and a new earth. It's going to be, you think about as He created. He created, He spoke this world in existence. Can God do that? If He wants a new heaven, new earth, He can thank it too. He can thank it. You know, God, we don't understand. God's an awesome, powerful God. But to pass away means to go off. It means to go off. We think about it in an earthly sense, to pass away, they go off the scene. A person passes away. We use that term a lot. Knowing that all the things on earth will pass away, all these things will pass away, it should put everything in perspective for me and you to say, when I say this place is not our home. The things we're working so hard for. I mean, don't that put it in perspective? The things we strive for, that we labor and we labor and we labor. I mean, man, I worked at a job for years. I worked 60, 70 hours every week at that job. And then I go work at a business all evening long, go home at 10 o'clock at night, get up every day at 3:45, only to do it again. And every bit of that's going to pass away. Does that not put life in perspective? It's going to go off the scene? Now, I'm not saying we shouldn't have anything, but should it be our first priority? Doesn't that put it, sort of put it in perspective for me when I studied the Scripture? What should be your first priority? Boy, I wish at this age I'd have got this God thing right. I didn't have God in my heart at this age, at your age. It makes a big difference, Ryan, when you get this perspective on life to see all of this around you is going to pass away. God should be number one. That's what that says to me. God should be my first priority. My first priority. I think you find that throughout Scripture. Any of you that's been in church any amount of time, you know this, don't you? God is number one. Jesus is number one in my life. You keep Him number one in your life. You keep Him number one, number two, three, four, five, and six. I promise you, God's made me a promise. It'll take care of God to take care of it. You'll be right in the will of God. If you keep Him number one, you keep your focus on the Word of God, you follow after Him, I promise you, God will take care of the rest of your life. That's the kind of perspective we should have. We strive, we work, we work, we work. Only to see here, John said, it all passed away. And you've heard the old sayings. Old preachers said this. When it comes to a hearse, they ain't taking none of that with them. They're talking about, put all the money in my casket, I'm going to take it with me. No, that money's buried in the ground, what it is. You didn't take it with you to heaven. You didn't take it with you to hell. None of it goes with you. At either place. It's not going to go, it's not going to go with you to heaven. It's not going to go with you to hell. Nothing on this earth. So that puts the thing, it's my soul. What does God value? He values you. That's what God's saying to us. God's saying, I don't value all these things. I value you. Your soul is what's important to me. Your life. God's saying, you're important to me. Everything's out else on this earth, it shall pass away. But not you. You're eternal. You're eternal. Every one of you is eternal. Brother Ryan, you don't know this. You're eternal. You will live forever in heaven or hell. Don't believe Satan's lie. I'm telling you, you'll live forever in one of two places, heaven or hell. What's God concerned about? He's concerned about your soul this morning. When it comes to your life, is he concerned about whether you have an Apple Watch? Well, he cares about all things, but his greatest concern is your soul. Stand with me this morning. We'll finish this message tonight. We'll look at 2 Peter tonight. Dave, if you put some